This is Springwatch, and we're coming to you live from Wales, where we're unfurling the secret lives of our cast of characters. And tonight, we've got a new family for you.
As always, we'll be celebrating the best of our UK's wildlife, and we'll be taking a rather beautiful look at orchards and looking at a whole host of animals there that's hard at work.
And we'll bring you right up to date with the latest dramas like this, our buzzers. Last night we left her battling the wind and the cold. What is going to happen? Find out with us on Springwatch.
Welcome to Springwatch. It's a Springwatch first tonight for this series. Do you know why? It's not raining.
The sun's just come out, literally, this second. Brilliant.
We are coming to you live from the very beautiful RSPB reserve at Innes here in Wales. There's 700 hectares here. It's a pretty big place. It's home to a variety of habitats, from wetlands to woodlands, marshes to moorlands. And we've got the whole place bugged so that we can keep you up to date on the daily dramas of a whole cast of wildlife characters.
And it'll be especially interesting this year because after this appalling start to spring, we'll be monitoring the effects of that on our wildlife throughout the whole series.
We promised you a new family, and we're not going to hold back. Let's go live to that nest straight away. Here it is. Now, it doesn't look much, does it, nestled down in the grass there, but you can see the chicks moving around. They only hatched a couple of days ago. Very small. There were five of them in there, but what are they? That's the question. Well, let's reveal all. They are meadow pipits. The meadow pipit is a little brown job, to be honest with you. An underrated bird, I would say. Quite closely related to the wagtails. And it's a bird of open country. It likes moorlands, it likes grasslands, woodland edges, but not woodlands themselves. And here you can see similar shape to the wagtail. And it's got that long tail with those characteristic white outer tail feathers. Sadly, state of nature, we mentioned that report last week. These birds have declined by about 40% in the last 25 years over all of the UK, which is a bit of a shame because they play an important role in many communities. Aside from eating things themselves, they're eaten by a lot, by predators such as merlins and hen harriers, but they're also parasitised by cuckoos, which lay their eggs into the nest. And where there are plenty of meadow pipits, up to one in five have their nest parasitised by cuckoos. Let's have a look now at what they've been up to today. Here are the chicks in the nest, and here come the adults, feeding them plenty of insects. They are insectivores. They'll eat a few seeds in the winter, and they get all of their food from the ground. They're a walking bird. They walk across the ground to find that food. And here, because it's been a bit nippy today, you can see that presumably the female is brooding the young. Other bird comes in here with a beak full of all sorts of insects, crane flies and another fly which looks to be a wasp mimic there. And in the process of poking around, that one masks the other bird depositing the food in their mouths. They're on the ground. I'll say they're vulnerable. I'm not entirely sure about that. That nest is very well hidden, I have to say. But we'll be following them over the next couple of weeks and hopefully they'll be fledging.
It's nice to see some live birds that aren't soggy and wet.
It is for once, yes, it's delightful. Yeah. Well, tonight you get more bang for your buck on Springwatch. Am I allowed to say that?
No.
Because after the main programme at 8:30, we're going to have Unsprung. And that's the one where we answer some of your questions. We note your observations on the wonderful world of British wildlife. And tonight we've got a baby deer coming into the studio.
Baby deer?
Got a baby deer.
Yeah, honestly. A small form with great big eyes, looking very attractive, just like Bambi.
Yes.
That's a sign. It's not his cup of tea. It's there for a reason.
What do you mean? I was bringing it up a treat for you.
To get into sort of interactive mood, we've got a quiz for you now. Now, this is how it works. Listen to this sound. Now, that's what the young folk call a mashup. That's actually three different types of crow, their calls. So there's lots of different sorts of crows. They could be carrion crows, jackdaws, magpies. But anyway, There are three different calls in that mashup, and we want you to tell us, in the right order, which bird is making which call. Let's hear it once again. Ooh, I thought it was quite easy to begin with, but now I'm beginning to think it's a little bit difficult.
It's not that easy.
It's not that easy. Anyway, if you think you know the answer to that, get in contact with us, bbc.co.uk/springwatch, or if you're on Twitter, #springwatch.
Now, we had plenty of tweets and comments on social media coming after the programme last night. Lots of you talking about the Osprey soap opera. So we thought it was only fair to keep you updated with the latest dramas.
It's been a dramatic breeding season so far for the ospreys on the Dovey estuary. But now, Monty has finally settled down with his third mate of the season, a massive female named Glesney. But they're leaving it very late to breed this year. Unusually, Glesney is still catching fish for herself. Females normally rely on the males to bring them food once courtship begins. But Glesney is a novice. This is her first breeding season. Things begin to look up when Glesney starts to bring in soft nesting material, a sure sign that she's beginning to get broody. And Monty takes the hint. Glesney makes a cup for the eggs, another encouraging sign that she may lay soon. Both birds are now working together, and when another osprey appears, there's no doubt that they're committed to each other as they mantle to protect their nest. But there are still no eggs, and other ospreys already have chicks. Finally, on the 22nd of May, almost 3 weeks since they paired up, Glesney lays a single egg. She steps carefully around the precious egg, but when these crows start to pester the nest, her immaturity shows. Monty chases off one of the intruders, but Glesney leaves the nest unprotected. Could this crow have cracked the vulnerable egg? 3 days after the first egg, Glesney lays her second. It's great news, but this pair have got a real challenge ahead. Will these eggs hatch in time? Will this first-time mum learn to protect them better? And even if they hatch successfully, the chicks will need to grow big enough to migrate to Africa by autumn.
Little hole like that, though, you see. If it's punctured the interior membrane, then infection can get in and the oxygen exchange won't be working properly.
But in my chickens, I've had little holes and they have hatched out.
If really?
It's small enough, yeah, they have. Yeah, they carried on. Mm-hmm.
There's no way of knowing, really, is there, how big that hole is?
No.
Fingers crossed, though, that it will hatch. But, you know, there's been more drama. Take a look at what happened just yesterday with the ospreys. There's our female, our young mum, sitting on the nest, protecting those two eggs now. And then she gets up. Obviously, something's coming in. That's not Monty. That's an intruder coming in. This happens a lot for the ospreys. But look, she's quite clumsy. She's stepping all over the eggs. But as I say, remember, she's a first-time mum. She's still learning.
There's
what
a distinct
to do.
Difference there. If you were watching carefully when she was incubating, as you said, Martin, she folded her talons in and they sort of walk around on their fist raptors when they're moving amongst their eggs, if they're turning them or anything like that. But of course, in that blind panic, she was jumping around with her talons out and she could easily puncture one of her own eggs if she's not careful. That is first-time mum habit. That's the sort of thing.
Every day there's a drama, isn't there, Chris, with those ospreys? And we'll certainly keep you updated with that. We had a lot of drama yesterday as well with our jackdaws, Jackdaw Jeopardy. We've got a nest box, two young chicks in. Now, remember, these aren't the parents coming in. They're intruders. And you can see that is not loving behaviour to the chicks. This intruder is attacking those chicks. It's very aggressive. It's pecking them, it's stamping on them, it's having a right go at them. Then what happens? one of the parent birds comes back, chases them off. That's what we showed on the programme last night. What has happened since? Fortunately, it's not been quite such a lot of hassle over the last 24 hours. No aggression at all. Let's have a look now live, see how those chicks are, because we were concerned about them. I mean, it was an attack, but they look like they're pretty healthy. I mean, I know one of them's asleep there, but throughout the day we've been watching them, and it looks like they're not unharmed. They're still looking pretty strong and
their
healthy.
Feathers are growing very rapidly now. Every time we look at them as a day goes by, they're more and more feathered. These are quite large and robust birds. Now, it is like a game of police and thieves down there, but take a look at this as well, because the actual parents are constantly reasserting their pair bond, because jackdaws are one of those birds which truly mate for life. Once they've found a mate, normally in their second year, they will stick with them all the way through their lives. If one of them dies, that can be a bit of a disaster, particularly if it's the male that dies, because female jackdaws normally find higher-ranking males to pair with. So if a higher-ranking male dies and you're his mate, you lose your ranking, and you have to find a lower-ranking male if you're lucky enough to find one at all. But all that beautiful posturing, we see quite a lot of that in the crows, and it's something that you can watch for yourself. And I can recommend a good book, King Solomon's Ring. King Solomon's Ring, all about jackdaws and watching their behaviour. Fantastic.
Can I just say that although everything seems to have calmed down now with the jackdaws, and it looks like they're going to be okay, we don't know. We don't write the scripts. They write the scripts and anything could happen. The jeopardy could come back.
Glad it's calmed down. Now, many of you have got in contact to report unusual behaviour, animals behaving in inventive and strange ways in response to this very unusual spring that we've been having. And I went down to the seaside to investigate one such report.
This is Kimmeridge Bay in Dorset. Beautiful. Beautiful but slightly smelly. Yet these great piles of decomposing seaweed are a crucial resource for a host of wildlife.
Now, whereas you and I might give it a miss on our way down to the beach, the strand line here is a really rich habitat. And in fact, on strand lines all around the country this spring, some very curious things have been going on.
And this year, it's not just been our usual coastal birds like gulls, wagtails and rock pipits that have been seen on the beach. There have also been sightings of more typically garden birds, robins, chiffchaff, wrens. So what are they doing down here? To unravel the mystery, marine biologist Maya Plass is rooting around in rotting seaweed.
Maya. Heaps of rotting vegetation.
It really
gorgeous.
Is, yeah.
What have we got?
Well, we there's so much here. You can see already on the surface, but when we peel back, take a look in here.
Oh, look,
absolutely
of
packed. Oh, look, already. Can you see there's some sandhoppers?
Sandhoppers.
Oh, look, Martin, look, there's
look
a whole
the
load of maggots in
look
here.
Look at that.
Tons of them.
Loads of lovely... And it's so warm here.
It really is, and it's not the sun that's eating this. It's the rotting seaweed that's generating this heat to create this lovely microclimate for the invertebrates to breed and the larvae to grow.
Chemicals released by decomposing algae attract the flies, and sheltered under the layer of seaweed, they can breed all year round.
Actually got a thermometer here so we can
have
a probe.
Of course you have.
And see
just how warm it really is.
So this green one here measures the temperature of the air.
Okay.
And this probe we can stick into the seaweed, so if we have a go in here. So already we can see this has gone up, going
it's
up to
going
19.
Up, going up.
And the aerial temperature is 13. So we've got an additional 6 degrees.
6 degrees or more, yeah. So I suppose this year it's been so freezing cold inland, there's nothing going on.
Absolutely. So it's just been too cold for the insects to grow on land. But here we've managed to maintain this warm temperature from all this lovely rotting seaweed.
So the sort of mystery this year of these curious birds that have come down, you've solved it, really, because they're coming down to feed on all these invertebrates.
That's right.
And as if to prove the point, a few minutes later, we were joined by a wren. Now, we believe this is the first year a wren has been seen down on the beach here at Kimmeridge. And it may even be building a nest in the bank. and it's certainly feasting on all these flying beetles. To get a closer look at the wealth of life in the strandline, we put out some pitfall traps.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Tray's standing by.
Let's go.
The whole lid's full of it.
Oh, look, they're all going. Oh. They're all just going, wow, look at that. That's a lot of sandhoppers. And you can see there's even some little baby ones in here
Gosh.
As well. Showing that they do breed in this strand line.
Look how much biology there is
Lots
going
of
on
beetles.
Here.
Beetles. There's not as many places on land that you turn a rock and find quite so many invertebrates,
so
are there?
No. You turn a stone over in my garden, you wouldn't find anything like this.
Sandhoppers are crustaceans that leap by tucking in their abdomens and flicking them out. And they also navigate using the sun and the moon.
The total biomass on this beach must be astronomical,
It's
mustn't
huge,
it?
Isn't it?
I mean, just in this small area, we've got hundreds. Multiply that over the whole of the strand line, it's astronomical.
You can just see why so many birds come down to the strand line
yeah.
to feed.
I'm surprised more don't, to be honest. So my people might want to tidy up the strand line, and it looks a bit messy, but actually that would be a disaster, wouldn't it?
It really would. I mean, this mobile buffet feeds so many creatures, as well as the marine creatures. You'd be taking away a whole food web if you move the strand line.
And I think this year in particular, the strand line's become a genuine lifeline for lots of our favourite birds.
It really has.
It just goes to show, really, that it's the animals that adapt and exploit that end up doing well. It's something that us as humans do far too well, in fact. But I think that film really reminds us, don't always clear your beaches. Leave the debris there. It provides an important habitat for all sorts of animals.
I can't see that always working. I mean, it's a great idea ecologically, but can you see the beaches of Malibu with all the A-listers? You know, you can just see Paris Hilton, can't you, spread out on the sand with a rotting pile of seaweed behind her.
OK, well, just leave some of it then.
OK, just some of it there.
Over the series, actually, we're going to be looking more at how wildlife is coping with this late spring. And send us in your comments. Let us know what you've noticed. Lots of you have told us about the beautiful bluebells that are all around. And there are fantastic carpets of those right at this moment. But send all your comments in to the usual website, bbc.co.uk/springwatch. And that's also the place to go, and the red button, if you want to continue watching all our live cameras once we've gone off air.
In order to explore all of our habitats, we've come down here to the edge of the marsh. Now, this lake that we've got behind us here looks like a natural one, but I can tell you just 13 years ago, this was artificial grassland. The RSPB have done a fantastic job. They built a sluice, they flooded it, and now it's full of life. It really is a top spot, isn't it?
Well, we've got a camera, a live camera on it. We've imaginatively called it Marsh Cam. We've also got one of our cameramen right now getting all sorts of interesting wildlife, Lindsay down there, and I think we might have something on the marsh cam at the moment. Let's have a look at it live. Oh, it's always a beautiful sight, isn't it? Always
it is,
beautiful.
Yeah.
No cygnets, I don't think. I mean, this time last year on Springwatch, we had cygnets, didn't we?
We did. But I tell you, Lindsay's been out there. He's been really busy. Take a look at this. This is one of our favourite animals that we've been lucky enough to catch on the marsh cam. It's an otter. Now, we have seen them here in the last couple of years on Springwatch, but this one has turned up in daylight, which is always a treat. And, of course, as we've been talking about already, Michaela, this is one of the few species that are doing really well here at the moment. They've spread back into all of the English counties. They were always doing pretty well in Scotland and Wales, it's got to be said, but it's always a treat to see them. Had great views last night, of course, with those urban otters as well.
Now, otters aren't a major threat to wetland birds, although they will take them opportunistically.
They will do, yeah, particularly things like coots and moorhens and perhaps even water rails. Those things which are nesting close, if they happen across them, they might have them, but typically they're fish. Up to 95% of their diet's fish.
A bigger threat is the weasel. Now, we've got lots of nesting birds around the wetland area, and we saw this on the programme last night. This is our family of buntings, the chicks there, and the weasel comes in and unfortunately predates all of them. Now, that weasel could be a problem for some of our other nesting families, couldn't it? We've got lots around that wetland area. Let's have a look at our reed buntings. They're not very far away from where the dunnocks were. There are five chicks. This is yesterday. five healthy-looking chicks in there, but they have a little bit of a strategy for survival. Let's have a look at this. This is one of the little chicks fledging. They fledge really early, and that's part of their survival strategy.
It is. They fledge after about sort of 9 days, 9 or 10 days, which is 3 or 4 days before they can fly. For them, it's, you know, death or glory. You know, they've got to get out of the way of any of those predators. And in order to do that, they fledge early and disperse. So, you know, when we saw the weasel come in?
Yeah.
All of the eggs were in one, well, all the chicks were in one basket, and it just went back and back and took them all. In the case of these reed buntings, they've spread themselves out now in the grass, and the idea is that the weasel won't find them all, it might just find one.
I'm a bit concerned, though, about that chick that did come out, because surely the idea is to hunker down, not go up. Makes you more obvious for predators. Let's have a look at that nest live now. Now, how many are in there now?
Well, no, we went. That was the water owl. Here we
are. Because I was going to say, I thought it was empty.
This is our reed bunting. Let's move in as close as we can. I have a suspicion, Michaela, they may have all gone. And we only saw the one leaving through the front, but that would be typical. All of those other... Yeah, it does look empty to me now. I think what's happened here is that all of those youngsters, during the course of the day, have skulked away into that thick tussock of grass. And they probably spread themselves out over just a few metres. They're not going to go too far, because the adults will still need to find them when they come back with food. They may even go back into the nest so they can be brooded overnight. I'm not sure about all that, or they may stay separate. We'll have to keep our eyes open to see what happens there.
Well, another nest that's very close to that nest is the water rail. Let's have a look at our water rail. Now, obviously, this is quite a precarious nest, because, again, a weasel could come in. But what I have noticed is one of the adults is never really off the nest. There's always one of them sitting on the eggs,
yeah,
protecting the eggs. But I suppose the weasel could come and take the adult. Nothing's stopping that happening.
It could. Our story developers have been watching this intently, and the longest period they've seen either the male or the female difficult to separate off the nest is 8 minutes and 20 seconds. And typically they're only off for about 20 seconds. So they're sitting really tight, which is perfect. But, you know, you can see there how difficult these birds would be to spot in amongst the reeds, but not difficult to hear, because although they're shy and they're skulking, they are very, very noisy birds. But this has been a unique opportunity for us to listen to some of their calls. Take a look and listen at this. I like the way that probably the female wakes up, gives a little groan, and then goes straight back to sleep. We think that this is a contact call between the male and the female, or the female and the male, that the other bird was quite close to the nest there. There are a list of about 7 calls listed in the Birders' Bible, Birds of the Western Pale Arctic, and I thought initially that that wasn't one of them, that we'd discovered something new, but it turns out that that call has been heard before, as had this one. This is the one that you will typically hear if you go out listening for water rails. Sounds like a squealing pig, doesn't it? It does, though.
It's a fantastic noise.
I know. And I think what you can't appreciate there is just how noisy it is. And they do call a lot at night, so if you go out to reed beds, you'll soon detect whether there are water whales there or not. Water whales. It's a weak R problem. The wagged rabbit round the rocks. I'll practice later. The water whales are there because you'll hear this call. And we call it charming, tonight's word, charming. These water whales are charming. I'm not entirely sure where that word comes from. If you know, do let us know. I couldn't find out today.
Is it a surprise, though, Chris, that they're making so much noise when they're sitting on eggs? I would have thought they'd want to be quiet not alert predators.
They do it when they're fighting territorially, but yes, calling from the nest and making all of that noise is slightly unusual.
But it's not just predators that are a threat to the water rail. Of course, flooding is a problem too. Now, we've seen over the last few days that water rail building her nest higher and higher in case that happens. But it's doubtful that the water rail would have survived the terrible floods that we had in this part of Wales last year on Springwatch, that not only played havoc for the wildlife, but for the people as well. Well, earlier on, I went down to the river that feeds this marsh to see what the long-term damage of those floods is. This is the river that runs through the reserve, and of course it provides amazing habitats for all sorts of wildlife. But this is also the river that last year rose so high that it burst its banks after a weekend of torrential rain, causing mayhem and destruction, not only for us and the wildlife, but also for the river system itself.
But a year later, and it's a very different river.
Just take a look at this. This was caused by last year's floods. The water level was so high that it caused the whole side of the bank to collapse. But you know, floods don't just destroy, they also create.
Wildlife cameraman Ian Llewellyn is filming some birds that are taking advantage of the debris left by the flood.
Hi Ian, what are you filming?
Just behind the gorse here and where the river came up last year and deposited all of its debris, there's a lovely little female blackbird who's woven herself a quite a delicious little nest just in the back there.
Is she on eggs or have they hatched?
Yeah, no, she's currently on eggs.
How many, do you know?
I think last time I looked she had three. I think she may have laid another one.
Further upstream, a wren has also built a nest in the debris. But Ian wants to show me the home of an iconic river bird that last year bore the full force of nature. It's the kingfisher. And Ian has a special license that allows us to take a closer look.
This is the hole from the nest we had on Springwatch last year.
Yeah.
And this is where Lindsay managed to film the mink raiding the chicks last year.
Tragically, high water levels allowed a mink to raid the kingfisher's nest and kill all its chicks.
But I guess if the mink hadn't got them, the floods would have done, because they came up to what? Here?
Yeah.
Over the bank?
The top of the flood is basically here, so if the mink hadn't... Here comes the kingfisher now.
But is this a sensible place to nest for a kingfisher?
It's a bit low, to be honest, for a kingfisher. A really good kingfisher nest should be 6.5 feet off the ground. Whereas here, I mean, once the water raises to here, and rats can just come straight into there and mink like they did when Lindsay managed to catch it on film.
So although last year's floods have created nests for some birds, they're still at the mercy of the river. Fingers crossed we don't have a repeat of last year's torrential weather.
I tell you, my fingers are firmly crossed. We certainly don't want to see a repeat of that. But you know those kingfishers' nests, despite the fact that a kingfisher was flying across when we were having a look at them, doesn't look like they're going to be used this year.
It's a bit late, isn't it?
Yeah, a bit late.
Right.
Those birds were using all of their flotsam and jetsam to make those nests there, and birds will use all sorts of materials to form their nest. It's probably easier to say a list of things that they don't use, actually, than the things that they do use. Although, having said that, they don't use corrugated iron or Second World War fighter aircraft or KTAL records from the 1980s. But nevertheless, they use all sorts of different natural and unnatural material. Take a look at this wren. This little wren we spotted earlier, probably a male, because male wrens make sometimes up to 5 nests in order to attract a female. And this one is really busy collecting moss and taking it to the nest, which is hidden very cleverly up in this bank here. And you can just about make out some of the moss there. Now, when the nest is chosen to be the one that's going to be used by the female, it's lined with fine grasses and hairs, and it forms a much softer cup inside. This little siskin here is not going to find a softer cup, because it's going to use this sheep's wool, which it's taking off of this barbed wire, to line its nest. That's fantastic, isn't it? Look at that. Look at that. So resourceful. Let's go live to our jackdaws, because it's not just siskins that have monopolised the sheep's wool. Look at this, a veritable shepherd's delight in there. A whole pile of wool, although jackdaws will add all sorts of things into their nest. Look, you can see bits of plastic there, bits of twig, of course, all sorts of unnatural material. Jackdaws famous for bringing in all sorts of twinkling things, stealing rings, of course. There were plenty of stories about that. Yeah. Maybe even KTAL records from the 1980s. I'm not entirely sure.
We'll have to test them. We'll put some outside the nest.
They don't just use discarded bits of animals either. As we can see here, look at that. This photo from Jill Moore, She says a holidaymaker saw the horse lying on her side with a jackdaw on her, came running to the door, really upset to tell them Millie was being pecked away, but Millie was in ecstasy, the horse. Because, of course, the jackdaws do give back, because if there are parasites there, they will actually peck out the parasites as well while they're taking nesting material from the live horse.
Martin, do you know when you were having your hair cut the other day, I saw a jackdaw come down and take some of your hair and put it in our nest?
That's an absolute fib, isn't it?
Absolute fib. I made it up. But, you know, a photo like that is great because it tells a story. You can take fantastic spectacle photographs. You can take photographs that tell stories. And that's exactly what we're encouraging you to do as part of BBC Summer of Wildlife. We want you to see it, snap it, and share it. And you can share it by going on to our website, bbc.co.uk/springwatch, and sharing it with us. And there's also lots of details on the website about how to take good wildlife photographs as well.
Another thing that's on there is a guide as to how to feed wildlife. Now, this is really important. It's not just about feeding birds, it's about feeding all sorts of wildlife in your garden, mammals and insects with nectar, all of that sort of thing. Let's go live to our feeders, because, of course, we're feeding the birds here at the moment. I didn't expect to see too much there at this time of night, I've got to say, principally because many birds at the moment have broods of young, and at this time of year, they will concentrate on insects because they want protein. However, we have seen some birds on the feeder earlier today. There's siskins there. Now, these are likely to be adult birds having a quick snack in between gathering all of those insects. And up here, look, there's a great tit. It's found itself a sunflower heart. It's snacking on that before it nips off and then carries on, presumably and hopefully, feeding its young. Of course, if these are non-breeding birds or birds which have failed, they might spend more time at the feeder. But look, this is what we expect to see at this time of year. We expect to see a lot more birds with invertebrate food. Song thrush with worms, dipper with all sorts of aquatic invertebrates there.
Let's have a quick recap of our Corvid conundrum, our quiz. Remember, there are three different types of crow making sounds here. Let's hear it again. If you think you know what those three different sorts of crows are and the order in which they're making those sounds, please get in contact, bbc.co.uk/springwatch or hashtag springwatch for Twitter.
Now, Springwatch is a celebration of wildlife, but sometimes wildlife and beauty can be found working hand in hand in surprising places, as our cameraman Richard Taylor-Jones discovered.
Britain is an industrious nation, built on a willingness to work. And in Somerset, there is an ancient tradition, centuries old, of working the land for apples, whose golden drink has long sustained our busy lives. Here, in the orchards, amongst the trees, the lines of wooden workers, I've come to find our British wildlife. Because it works here too. Roe deer come to graze, the orchard hedgerow offering a tasty breakfast. The deer's work doesn't look hard, but it is persistent. It must eat and eat to sate its hunger. There's little goodness in its leafy diet. But finally, after the longest of winters, sustenance will arrive in the orchard. The warmth of spring is at last bringing its blossom. The trees promise that later in the year there will be autumn fruit. It's a beautiful promise, but it comes with one golden rule. There must be workers. Honeybees. They're brought here every year, shipped in to pollinate the blossom and work for their honey. Out in the orchards, they gather their harvest, taking nectar and moving pollen between the blooms, helping to fertilize them. And in their hives, they're working to build their comb and tend to the young, only disrupted by a dance, a waggle dance, to show where a new bounty has been found out amongst the trees. There are other workers in the orchard too, less celebrated than the honeybee, but still doing an important job. Bumblebees fly in colder weather. They fly in wetter weather. They fly longer days. And what of the night shift? Do our moths, oddly named nocturnal flyers, work in the orchard too? Some of us are trying to find out. The pebble prominent, the clouded drab, the Hebrew character. They're here, but are they playing their part in pollinating? The truth is, not even the experts know. They need more time to study. With the rising sun, it's another day. The dawn chorus, a reminder that it's not just the insects that live here, but birds too. And amongst the blossoms, blue tits. Just as some insects are the orchard's friends, others are not. And the blue tits are the orchard's pest control company, bouncing through the boughs. They peck and pick for insects with precision and take the odd blossom or two for their time. And as they leave, off to work their next tree, in a quest to help the nation's dreams of drink come true, I too must take my leave. My thirst for nature, well and truly quenched.
You know, you can find so much beauty in nature, but sometimes you've just got to stop, take the time, and really appreciate it. Absolutely stunning. Now, still to come on tonight's programme, what's on our buzzard chicks menu? It's something a little bit surprising.
And I take a look at one of my favourite birds and launch our Springwatch survey this year.
Martin will be getting his knees dirty as he takes a macro look at the creatures of the undergrowth.
All good stuff. Now, we're continuing to explore the reserve here, so we've come down to Heron Point, and you can see the salt marsh stretched out behind us here. Well, we call it Heron Point. When I was meeting one of the locals the other day, they said that this was called Lover's Rock.
Okay, there we are. We've come down here because there's some woodland just behind us amongst all of this habitat, and you've been in there and seen that the bluebells are still in flower. They're way behind, but of course they're not the only things that are behind.
We've got our great tits, they're nesting late. Let's go to them live now. They seem to have been doing pretty well. There are all the chicks, all looking healthy. What do you reckon, Chris? When are they going to be ready to fledge?
Well, look, in the last couple of days, they've grown considerably, and you can see now what we call their pin feathers, their primary flight feathers and their tail feathers, which are covered in this waxy sheath, and you can already see the wing bars on their wings there. So, yes, they're still huddled together. It's a cool evening here, but they've been being fed well, and the five of them that have survived are all looking good.
Yeah, we were a bit worried that there might be one not being fed so much, and there are a few comments on Twitter about that, but looks like, as Chris says, all five of them are doing equally well.
And it's not just our great tits that are out in the woods just over here, because just literally over there, well, not just, but a couple of hundred metres over there, which is why I'm raising my voice, is our buzzard's nest. Let's go live to it now. Now, if you were watching last night, you'll know that we were looking at potentially the most miserable buzzard in Christendom, because it had spent the whole day getting soaking wet in order to properly brood its young. But here, look, a far more attractive, I have to say, and a far more content-looking buzzard.
And there's been quite a lot of activity on the buzzard nest today. A lot of different prey food is being brought in, and some of it quite surprising. That is a mole. Chris, that's not what you'd expect a buzzard to be feeding its
chicks. It isn't, because, you know, moles stay free of predation by spending all of their lives beneath the ground, quite literally. There's only a short period when a few youngsters come above ground in August. So that's interesting, but then look at this. This is interesting too. It's an eel.
And what is quite amusing is it doesn't seem to know exactly what to do with that eel.
No, it doesn't, and I'm not surprised, because they probably don't catch too many of them, and that's showing a real sense of opportunity when it comes to diet. But I've got a theory as to what's going on here.
Give me your theory, Chris.
My theory is this. We've seen them eating lots of frogs. It's been very rainy. It's likely that these amphibians would have been active in the woodland and the buzzards would have therefore taken them. They've eaten a lot more frogs in the last few days than buzzards typically eat. Then the mole. If it had been flooded, that might have driven the mole up out of the ground onto the surface, and therefore the buzzards might have caught it. And lastly, the eels. Now, these animals will spend quite large amounts of time and travel long distances out of the water, but they'll only do it when it's flooded or damp. So I think that these things that we're seeing in the buzzard's diet are all to do with the weather.
They've basically exploited the situation. They've taken full advantage, which means they'll be successful, hopefully.
Indeed. And they are exploiting the living woodland. But a key component of any woodland is its dead wood. And we've used some of this to form our rodentorium. Here's our rodentorium. It's an old dead log. But dead wood is an incredibly important thing, as Martin knows, don't you, mate?
I certainly do, Chris. Here I am in the beautiful, wide-open spaces of the woods, but we're going to go into micro-world. Look at these bluebells, so late this year. Right, let us go along here. Now, in this wood, it's absolutely full of rotting wood, and that is a terribly important habitat. Let us quickly go back to the rodentorium, which is itself rotten wood. Have a look at this. Now, in here last night, we recorded this. Do you see that beetle? That's a violet ground beetle, and it's, if you were a little thing, it's a tremendous predator. It's got fearsome jaws. Now, what's going on here? I'm not sure. I was told that it was eating a woodlouse. It so definitely is not eating a woodlouse at all. It's eating a seed, which is very, very curious. Now, I remember once being out in the garden one evening and I heard a squelching noise. I went to investigate and it was a violet ground beetle munching its way through a slug. Tremendous animals. Now, let's have a closer look at a beetle. Let me get down here. I've got one in my hand. Put that down. Now, this is a door beetle, a relative of that violet ground beetle. Now, I don't know if you can see. If I turn it over, I'm sorry, mate. Can you see that beautiful colour underneath? That violet colour. Let's have a little look as well. We've been filming it in the macro studio. There it is, moving along. On rotten wood, important to see. Look at those antennae too, detecting all sorts of smells and things there. That's a door beetle. Lovely things. Now, beetles, look upon this. This is one, let's get it the right way around, one of the most successful designs on Earth. That. The great biologist JBS Haldane was asked, what could be inferred about the work of the creator by studying his works? And he said, God had an inordinate fondness for beetles. And that's because a quarter of all the species on the planet are beetles. That's about 400,000. We've got 4,000 beetles like this in the UK alone. And one of the reasons why they're so successful is that they live in different, the adult and the larvae live in different areas. The larvae of many beetles will live in rotting wood. It's a terribly important habitat for them. There's nothing in here. Oh, there's a centipede, but have a look. There we go. In rotting wood, there is a beetle larva. So different from the adult, completely and utterly different. Munching its way, and of course it's terribly important, these beetle larvae, because they break down wood and they help recycle all the nutrients in the garden. Now, another reason why they're fantastically successful, okay, what they do is they live the larvae in the wood, but the adults, the phase that disperses and mates, they have another trick up their sleeve. Let's look at an adult beetle. This is a longhorn beetle, for obvious reasons. Very armour-plated, very protected. Fantastic sensory systems there. But it's got another wonderful trick up its sleeve that makes beetles so successful. They're very protected on the back, but those hard cases on the back are actually modified wings. Now, what else can a beetle do? It can do this wonderful trick. Here it goes. It can, wait for it, fly! That's what they can do, they can fly. So they can disperse over enormous areas. Beetles are fabulously successful creatures. And now we'll go from a fantastically successful group of animals to one animal that was successful, but now seems to be in trouble.
Last night, I rang around the few people I know who go birding, good birders, here in the New Forest, asking them if there was anywhere they knew any kestrels we could go and look at this morning, because there was none around here on my patch. Nothing. Not a single pair of kestrels in this area. What about that?
To me, this is almost unthinkable. Kestrels used to be our commonest birds of prey. My childhood was completely defined by these wonderful birds. I've been obsessed with them since I was a teenager. Finding my first kestrel's nest at the age of 14 was one of the greatest moments of my life.
I remember the day distinctly. It was the 6th of June. It says here in my diary, I found it, exclamation mark. I watched the male fly over me and then into the tree, and I heard the eyasses, the young birds, screaming. I sat under a hawthorn and watched at least three birds, but the male arrived and made a teet-teet sound. I was so excited about finding this nest that I was torn between staying there with my very cheap binoculars, watching the birds, or cycling furiously home to tell my dad about my trophy find. I plumped for the latter, and I remember cycling along Allington Lane on my chopper, singing Seasons in the Sun by Terry Jacks. And then getting home, running up the driveway, bursting through the door and saying, Dad, Dad, I found my first kestrel's nest. I remember it like it was yesterday, and I know exactly where the tree is. Sometimes I fly over it when I take off from Southampton Airport, and I look down, and I still look at that oak tree. My little heart misses a beat.
Ted Hughes wrote of the kestrel, effortlessly at height hangs his still eye. His wings hold all creation in weightless quiet, which in truth I think describes them perfectly. You see, they hover effortlessly, even in high winds. By constantly making small adjustments to their wings and tail feathers, these kestrels can keep their head and their large eyes completely steady. They use their acute eyesight to spot their prey and hunt a wide range of animals, including lizards, beetles, worms, but their main food is the field vole.
They're fantastic little predators, and even now, I take every opportunity to get close to one.
When I was 14, I got my first pet kestrel. I called it Tem, T-E-M, and it was the absolute epicentre of my adolescent life. I loved that bird. I loved it dearly. I got it on June the 25th, 1975, and very sadly, on the 6th of December that year, it died. It was a heartbreaking event. I went on to have some more kestrels and other birds too, but I still remember those days, getting up before school, taking it out to a patch of wasteland behind my house and flying it. This pretty little bird is a two-year-old male kestrel. You can tell it's a male. It's got that lovely slaty blue head and a slaty blue tail. Got quite small feet, not powerful feet. That's why I'm very happy to hold it without a glove, because they're used really just to grasping hold of their prey. They're not a killing, constricting foot like some of the larger raptors. They would normally kill their prey with a little nip to the back of the neck once they've grabbed hold of it.
When I was a child, I can remember being in the back seat of my dad's old Vauxhall Viva, going down the motorway, and I'd always see kestrels hovering alongside the road.
They were a very familiar sight, to the extent that many people, I think, took them for granted. But sadly, since then, in the time it's taken me to grow up, the population of this bird in the UK has collapsed. They've gone down by 30% in the last 25 years, perhaps more. So it's become a species of conservation concern.
The cause of the kestrel's decline is a bit of a mystery. One factor could be a lack of natural nest sites. The Hawk Conservancy is investigating this, and last autumn, a host of volunteers put up nearly 70 nest boxes across Hampshire, Wiltshire and Surrey. By monitoring the uptake of these man-made homes, they're hoping to discover if putting up boxes across the country could actually help the kestrels recover. There are also some other theories as to why these birds are in trouble.
Some people think that it's due to the increase in the number of buzzards, that they're competing for the same food, small mammals. Others, that it's the general intensification of agriculture. Too many pesticides for too long. One thing's for sure, the last couple of harsh winters and this wet spring certainly won't have helped our kestrels. But you know, the message it really sends to me is that we can never afford complacency when it comes to conservation. Because what's a common bird today can be a rarity tomorrow.
It's so true. You used to take that completely for granted, Chris. You know, the kestrel hovering as you were driving along the motorway. Mm. And do you know, we asked one of our cameramen to go out and get a shot of a kestrel in the reserve. Guess what? Couldn't find one.
No.
But there must be something we can do, and there is, isn't there, Chris?
The key to any conservation effort is that you have to know, you know, what's happening to the population and where it is. So we're really pleased to team up with the Hawk Conservancy Trust for our Kestrels Count survey. Go to our website and follow it through until you find that Kestrels Count. And what we want you to do is very simple. Just report all of your kestrel sightings over the next couple of weeks. We want to know where you've seen the kestrel, so you can give us a postcode. We want to know the time and the place. And we also want to know what you and it were doing. If you're eating a sandwich, we'd quite like to know. If the kestrel's eating a sandwich, that would be very interesting as well. And what we want to do is produce a map of all of our kestrel sightings by the end of the series so that we can see if there were any kestrel hot spots where we can work harder for conservation, or whether there are areas where they've already disappeared and perhaps putting up nest boxes might make a difference. So come on, let's go crazy for our kestrels. Keep your eyes open and please fill in that report form on our website.
Chris, you've obviously worked with kestrels a lot, you're passionate about them, but can you do an impersonation of a kestrel?
What, you mean sit like one or what?
No, make the sound a kestrel makes.
My kestrel sound?
Yeah. No, clearly
not. Of course
not. Martin, can you?
Yeah.
Go on then.
That's not bad.
That wasn't actually the film. Well, okay, it's not bad. But they do make a very shrill sound, and a lot of birds of prey do. However, barn owls make a very different sound. Can you do that one? That's pretty good. Let's see how good that is. Here is our barn owl that we're filming on the reserve. It's on eggs, and they tend to be very vocal. Listen. Very noisy birds. It's a sort of shriek, isn't it? That
They make a great range of sounds, barn owls. Everything's from high-pitched squeals through all of those hisses. You know, they're very, very vocal. And particularly when they've got a nest full of young, then if they're anywhere near the house, you won't get a wink of sleep.
This is what we saw on that camera a little bit earlier on. Look at this, a bit unusual. Squirrel is around, chased in by the barn owl. The barn owl goes in, squirrel pops out, looking a little bit nervous and agitated.
It is. It's flicking its tail, yeah. That's a sign of it being nervous.
But let's face it, it's a little bit too big to be a prey item for the barn owl, isn't it?
It would be a pretty fair fight, actually, squirrel versus barn owl. The barn owls are never going to try and predate a squirrel, but they would give a good account of themselves keeping them off the nest with their talons, yeah.
Shall we resolve the quiz?
I think we should.
Let's resolve our quiz. Remember, it's a corvid mashup. Let us hear it once again. OK, there are the three calls. A lot of you were close, but only a few were absolutely bang on. Carol Monger, James Common, Brooke Flitney, you all got it right. And it was. The first one was, let's hear it, a jay. Sounds very magpie-like too, doesn't it? And the second one was the rook. I had a pet one once called Claude. Magnificent. And the third one is a raven. I never had a pet one of them, but I fancy one. Right. Lovely. And they're not in that way. There'll be more quizzes after the show in Unsprung, and we've got animals coming. Got that baby deer coming in. And we've got answering all your questions and generally having quite a good time.
Now, for those of you that enjoyed our little baby rabbit yesterday, I thought you might enjoy this. This is very close to our production village, very close to your caravan, actually, Chris.
I've been peeping out the window looking at this hare.
And we saw this in the middle of the day, a hare which is really unusual and fabulous to get on camera. And we think we can see it so well at the moment because everything's late, including crops. So it's a bare field at the moment, the hares are out. And I'm not sure we've seen it the last couple of days, but as I say, saw that a couple of days ago. Pretty cool.
It is amazing. Pretty cool. People like hares, but look at this. You know, if you're after your little cutesy-bootsy animals, you've had baby rabbits, now you've had hares, now you can have a hoglet in hand. Duncan Richardson sent this one in.
We're going to be speaking to him later on the show.
Are you really?
Yes, literally.
On Unsprung.
Brilliant, yes.
What about that, then?
Fantastic.
Well, what have we got? You're almost at the end of the programme, very sadly. So I guess it's a question of what's coming up tomorrow. Well, I'm really pleased to say that Yolo Williams is heading out to Late Vyrnwy, and he's going there to see one of the best raptors that we have in the UK, the hen harrier. It's in a perilous position.
We'll be keeping our eyes on the live cameras. Will there be more jeopardy with our jackdaws? As I say, we don't know what's going to happen. The jackdaws and nature writes the script.
And with that weasel prowling around, remember we saw that, what's going to happen to our reed bunting and meadow pipit nest? Will the weasel have an unfortunate ending for them?
Well, we on Springwatch will be back tomorrow on BBC Two at 8 o'clock. But it's a whole Springwatch extravaganza. Springwatch in the afternoon tomorrow at 3 o'clock with Nick Baker. Keep your eyes on all the live cameras, on the red button and on the internet as well. But don't go anywhere because in just a couple of minutes, it is Springwatch Unsprung.